With that, let's begin. Let's recap last class where we have stopped. Okay, so hope you have seen this circuits last class, tuned circuit oscillators, are also called as LC oscillators. Okay, which are popular for the high frequency, you know, oscillation, you know, generation. Okay, you can generate oscillations from the frequency 200 kilohertz up to a few gigahertz. Using this LC oscillator or tuned oscillator. Similar to RC phase shift oscillator, the tank circuit is also important. The tank circuit is nothing but the feedback network. Amplifier, mainly it has got an amplifier stage, okay, followed by the feedback stage whose gain is going to be the beta. So, these two blocks interact with each other in the process of generation of oscillations here. So, there is an amplifier with an input and output. So, we take output of an amplifier and give it to the feedback network, and the output of the feedback network is given back to the amplifier input in this loop. Okay, so, the gain loop gain what we have seen, the A beta must be equal to or greater than unity, okay, in order to generate the oscillations. Okay, the product of these two, okay, must be greater than or equal to unity in order to generate the oscillations by the oscillator circuit. And same process even it is applicable for LC oscillator or tuned oscillator. Okay. And you have explained the last class the mechanism how oscillations are generated in the tank circuit of the LC circuit. Okay, we have shown that this capacitor, once it is fully charged and if it is connected across the an inductor, okay, so the energy transfer between the capacitor and the inductor and the inductor and the capacitor. Okay, so that creates an alternating current within this loop. Okay, so that alternating current itself generates, you know, the oscillations. Okay, we know that in capacitor the energy is stored in the electrostatic form, whereas in inductor the energy is stored in the magnetic form. Okay, so magnetic energy. Okay, so these two transfer of energy between these two elements generates oscillations within this loop here. That is the basic principle in the LC oscillator. Okay, in most of the tank circuits that we discuss in this section, especially the LC oscillator section, you will see the capacitor and inductor. Sometimes the number of capacitor may be more or number of inductors also may be more. Okay, that depends on the type of oscillator. So, this we explained in the last class how magnetostatic energy get transferred to the capacitor and how electrostatic energy get transferred to the inductor. These things we have discussed in the last class. This is the basic principle in generation of oscillations here. In order to overcome this, you know, the declined or damped kind of oscillations, we are supposed to use an amplifier stage which boosts gain each and every time when there is a decline in the, okay, so the current or voltage within the oscillator circuit, okay, in the tank circuit here. Okay, that can be overcome by using the amplifier. Okay, and the frequency of oscillations, it is a general formula which is given here. The frequency f is equal to 1 by 2 pi square root of L and C. We can see that there is a product of L and C within the square root here. Okay, so, this formula remains same for all the LC oscillators, but sometimes depending on the number of inductors or number of capacitors, slightly there may be changes in the formula of this. Okay. General form of this, you know, LC oscillator contains, you know, an amplifier stage and a tank circuit what you are seeing here. And this tank circuit, as I told you, it has three elements here, three impedances what we have shown here, Z1, Z2 and Z3 namely. Z1, Z2, Z3 we have denoted here in a general form, but this can be a capacitor or this can be an inductor also. Okay. Suppose if I consider an amplifier without since amplifier, operational amplifier does not draw any current because its input impedance is going to be very high. And so, this equivalent impedance of this tank circuit can be calculated, which is given as shown here. Since op amp does not draw any current because of its input impedance here, okay, if I say Zi of op amp is going to be an infinity, very large here. So, therefore, the larger the input impedance means the current drawn at inverting terminal and non-inverting terminal is going to be 0. So, op amp does not draw any current. So, therefore, current going into the op amp is 0. So, therefore, the equivalent of this is going to be Z1, Z3 will become in series, and that is in turn parallel with Z2. So this is the equivalent of feed tank circuit here. Okay, so this is the equivalent circuit. The operational amplifier that we have shown here can be represented with an output resistance of R0 and a voltage gain AV times VI. Okay, so this is an amplifier input which is going from the tank circuit here. Okay. Okay, so this is an analysis of amplifier stage. As I told you, mathematical formula derivations are not required for this topic, especially this oscillator part. Only thing is you must remember last end results here in this case. So here for an amplifier stage, the ratio of V0 by VI can be written as A, that is amplifier gain, that is given by minus AV times ZL divided by R0 plus ZL. So this can be easily derived also, but not necessary for your syllabus point of view. This is not required for syllabus point of view. Students should only remember the last results here. So therefore, A basic amplifier gain, which is by the definition we have V0 by VI, that is equal to this formula. Now look at tank circuit. Tank circuit even gain also can be calculated. We know that tank circuit gain is nothing but the beta. The beta is nothing but the output impedance. The you can apply voltage division rule here. So in terms of input voltage, so Vf is equal to V0 times Z1 divided by Z1 plus Z3. So that is the formula for beta. So beta is nothing but here you can see that beta, if there is a 180 degree phase shift must be introduced. So therefore, there is a negative sign we have shown here for the beta. Since amplifier introduces 180 degree phase shift, the total phase shift must be, including both amplifier and the feedback network, must be 360 degree. Okay, so that's as per the Barkhausen criteria. So in this case, it's A beta minus A beta as Barkhausen criteria, so it should be equal to 1. Okay, so that is the Barkhausen criteria. And these derivations are not required, so I will skip this derivations from your curriculum point of view. And look at here in LC oscillators, broadly we can classify into two types. One is Hartley oscillator, which is made up of two inductances, you can see here two inductors and one capacitor. Okay, so this is an Hartley oscillator tank circuit combination. And another type of LC oscillator is the Colpitt oscillator. So the Colpitt oscillator contains the two capacitors, so which is X1 and X2 are namely the capacitors, and X3 impedance is going to be the inductor. Okay, so using this combination of inductors and capacitors, we can have two types of oscillators. These are the popular oscillators here. Whenever we need to generate high frequencies, then we can move on to this Hartley and Colpitt oscillators. We have discussed RC oscillator in the last class. RC oscillators are chosen when the operating frequency is less than 100k. Okay, up to 200k this can be fine tuned. Okay, RC oscillator. And if we want to generate frequency more than 200k, in such case we go for Hartley and Colpitt oscillator. Okay, let's directly move on to the syllabus point of view. We don't have BJT based circuit. As per our syllabus, we have only FET based circuit. Of course, BJT based circuit and FET circuits, as you have seen here, there is no much difference. Okay, so only thing is if you remember for circuit diagram for the BJT, it's easy to write for even FET also. Just replace BJT, which is given here, with FET. The tank circuit and the rest of the circuit remains same. There is no change in the circuit. Of course, this is going to be an amplifier, as you can see here, this complete thing. Okay, is an amplifier, and this is going to be the tank circuit. So amplifier is introducing 180 degree phase shift. We are aware that common emitter amplifier produces 180 degree phase shift between the input here and output here. Okay, so between these two we can see 180 degree phase shift here. Okay, so that's the thing, and tank circuit also produces 180 degree phase shift here, and there is a special element called as a radio frequency choke here. This choke passes an AC signal and blocks the DC signal here. And basically this is used to separate AC and DC here. That's the importance of radio frequency choke, which is mainly used in both Hartley and Colpitt oscillators. There is no change in the tank circuit. Tank circuit, you can see here, the L1, L2 are going to be in series, that is in turn parallel with the capacitor. Two inductors and one capacitor forms the tank circuit of Hartley oscillator. Okay. The importance of RFC is given here, just to go through that. It isolates AC and DC signals. Okay. So, that is the intention of RFC. Okay, its reactance value is very high for high frequencies. Okay, so that's one thing you can observe here from the radio frequency choke. Hence, it can be treated as open circuit. For DC, it can be, the reactance is going to be zero. Hence, it can be treated as okay, short circuit here. Okay, so for DC elements here. Okay, these things we'll skip here. This is the derivation part, not necessary for your syllabus point of view. Whichever important, I will directly focus on that. Okay, so the equivalent inductance, considering the mutual inductance, is going to be L1 plus L2 plus 2M. And this is the frequency of oscillations which a student should remember this formula. So, problems will be asked based on the frequency of oscillations. The only change is C remains same in our, from our general formula, but L becomes now L equivalent. L equivalent is L1 plus L2 because both are in series here. This doesn't considers, you know, the mutual inductance. Once mutual inductance is included, the resultant formula is going to be this. L equivalent is, okay, L1 plus L2 plus 2M. So, that can be replaced here with L equivalent. But this formula, general formula, remains same for the Hartley oscillator. Okay. This is again another form of the problems are here. Kindly go through the problems. Problems are straightforward. Okay. So, either the capacitance and inductance will be given and asked you to calculate the frequency of oscillation, or else the frequency and one of these elements will be given. So, another element you are supposed to find. So, work out, you know, each of these problems. So, it is useful to you in examination and as well as IA also. This is what the circuit diagram for FET based Hartley oscillator. As you can see here, the only change is the BJT got replaced by the field effector transistor. The other circuit element elements remain same. Okay, there is no change. Okay, and even operation also remains same here. So, in examination, I would suggest to whenever they ask you generally the Hartley oscillator, then write this FET based only. Specifically, if they ask you FET Hartley oscillator, then you can write this. Okay. While writing this, you know, the operation, first explain the basic amplifier working principle, then the tank circuit, then finally the frequency of oscillations and equivalent of inductance. Those things can be explained. Okay. So, make it very simple, don't make it complicated, and write only essential things in examinations. Okay. First thing is you need to write correct circuit. Okay. Then comes the frequency of oscillation formula, then the equivalent inductance formula. Okay. These are the three things which you must not forget while writing, while answering this question in examination. Problems on this topic will be very simple. As I told you, it is straightforward. Only thing is the problems depend on this formula only. Just remember this formula and you will be in a position to solve any type of problems in examination. Colpitt oscillator, there is no much difference between Hartley and Colpitt. The only thing is inductance get changed by capacitor and in the capacitor get changed by the inductor. That is the only change you see in this Colpitt oscillator. Okay. Overall, the basic principle remains same. There is an amplifier here and there is a tank circuit. The amplifier introduces 180 degree feedback from this. The tank circuit also introduces 180 degree feedback. According to Barkhushen criterion, there must be a 360 degree feedback, okay, 360 degree phase shift, okay, from the input to the output. So, that is the criteria, and loop gain must be equal to 1, A beta must be equal to 1. The modulus of this, if it is equal to 1, these are the two conditions should be satisfied according to Barkhushen criterion. Okay. And the frequency of oscillations, just I will focus on the final results. Okay, so this is the frequency of oscillation formula. So f is equal to 1 by 2 pi into square root of L into C equivalent here. C equivalent you can see here, C equivalent since capacitors are in series, it is C1 C2 divided by C1 plus C2. This is the formula for equivalent of capacitance. So this is the frequency of operation expression. So students should remember this. Okay, there is even short method, shortcut methods like HFE can also be equivalent to the, is equivalent to the ratio of C2 by C1. Okay. So just remember these three things, circuit diagram, the basic principles, operation like, you know, Barkhausen criterion, and then followed by the these expressions, that is important. This is again FET based Kolpit oscillator, there is no much difference between BJT based and FET based, and also see the formulas related to the FET based Kolpit oscillator. Okay. And their problems are here, which is straightforward. I advise students to go through each and every problem. Every problem is going to be different, but only thing is it relies on the general formula that we have discussed, like equivalent capacitance, and we need to calculate the frequency of operations here. So this is straightforward. Okay. So in this case, you can see that inductance value is given and capacitor value you are supposed to find. So here you can assume one and find the other one here. Or C equivalent can be equal to C by 2 when we assume both capacitors are equal. Then you can find the capacitance value here. The capacitance value is going to be 2.026 nanofarad, like this. Okay. Next comes what is called as a clap oscillator. Okay, clap oscillator it overcomes the drawback of Kolpit oscillator. Kolpit oscillator problem is the frequency stability here. So this is the main issue with Kolpit oscillator here. What do you mean by frequency stability here? We know that transistor operate used in the Kolpit oscillator, that is especially the BJT or FET, they depend on various parameters. And whenever the parameter change, the frequency of operation will not be stable. The frequency will become unstable here. Okay. Now, how do you tackle this issue when the frequency is unstable? Because when we say oscillator, the frequency must be stable. The operation frequency must be stable here. So that is the main problem with Kolpit and Hartley capacitors also. But here the problem can be overcome by using, you know, the capacitor, as you can see in the tank circuit. Okay, so in the tank circuit, the capacitance, instead of using only the inductor, okay, parallel to these two capacitors C1 and C2, we are using another capacitor here called as a C3. Okay. So this slight modification to the tank circuit of Kolpit oscillator is nothing but the clap oscillator here. Okay, the clap oscillator which overcomes the frequency stability problem of Kolpit oscillator. Okay, so this is the tank circuit, okay, of clap oscillator here. Okay, the slight change here, and now we can see the equivalent capacitance now becomes, all three will be now in parallel. So that series actually, so this is series equivalent is going to be 1 by C equivalent is equal to 1 by C1 plus 1 by C2 plus 1 by C3. So this is the equivalent formula for the this tank circuit, and the frequency of oscillations for the clap oscillator is as shown here, 1 by 2 pi root of L into C equivalent. Now C equivalent is obtained from this relation. Okay. And now here there is a example here to illustrate how this clap oscillator is different from Kolpit oscillator here. Let us see, go through the example here. And here one thing what I would suggest is you must choose a capacitance C3 smaller compared to the C1 and C2. That is a general idea to obtain a frequency stability here. Okay. This capacitance C3 must be chosen, this value must be smaller, okay, compared to this C1 and C2 here. Okay, so in this example, as you can see, C1 and C2 we have taken as 0.001 microfarad, okay, and inductance that is fixed, which is 15 micro Henry, and the new capacitor which is in parallel to in series to this C1 and C2, 50 picofarad we have chosen. As you can see here, this capacitor is very small compared to this two capacitors C1 and C2. Let us calculate now equivalent capacitance of this using this relation. 1 by C equivalent equals 1 by C1, 1 by C2 and 1 by C3. So, the equivalent capacitance value is found to be 4.545 into 10 to the power of minus 11 farad, and you can substitute in the formula for frequency of oscillation. The frequency of oscillations can be estimated. The oscillation frequency is found to be 6.09 megahertz. Okay. Now, you can see here the small change we are going to introduce here. So, if I neglect C1 and C2, what is going to happen? In this frequency of oscillation, if I neglect C1 and C2, the C equivalent just becomes equal to, in this formula, if I am neglecting C1 and C2, 1 by C equivalent becomes equal to 1 by C3. Okay. And in the frequency of oscillation expression, F becomes equal to 1 by 2 pi into square root of L into C3, okay, because C1 and C3, C1 and C2, I am neglecting it here. Let us see the implications of neglecting C1 and the C2 here. So, C1 and C2 if neglected, you can see the frequency of oscillation, if you recalculate it for the previous problem, it is found to be 5.82 megahertz. Now, compare, you know, the previous frequency including C1 and C2, it was 6.09 megahertz. Neglecting C1 and C2, the frequency of operation is 5.82 megahertz here. You do not find much difference between the this frequency with C1 and C2 and without the C1 and C2 here. Okay. So, that means the impact of this C1 and C2 is very small on the frequency of oscillation compared to C3. Though we choose the C3 value very small, the frequency mainly depends on the C3, frequency of operation depends on the C3. Okay, so, this is the formula for frequency of operation for the C1 and C2 neglected. Okay. And here we have a circuit diagram for the same. Just now we have discussed only the tank circuit part of this clap oscillator. Okay. So, now you can see that we have replaced earlier Colpitt oscillator with new modified tank circuit here. Okay. Now, this frequency mainly depends on frequency here depends on the C3 here. Okay. So, this is a complete transistor circuit including both amplifier and as well as the tank circuit here. Okay. Any questions here so far? So, this is about clap oscillator. Before we move to the final part of our topic, which is basically the crystal oscillators, which is an important type of oscillator used in most of the circuits like in communication circuits, especially the transmitters and receivers, and even in CPUs also you can see that, you know, in microprocessors especially we use crystal oscillators. The reason for using crystal oscillators is because the frequency stability here. When you use these oscillators in the circuit such as transmitters and receivers and even in digital circuits, okay, the frequency of operations, you know, frequency will not vary too much. That is the reason behind using crystal oscillators in all the digital circuits here. Now, let us see the basic things about crystal oscillator. What is this crystal oscillator and how this crystal oscillator generates, you know, the oscillations of higher frequency, and how the frequency is going to be stable, all those things we will discuss here. So, before we understand crystal oscillator, one must understand the effect called as piezoelectric effect. What do we mean by piezoelectric effect? So, piezoelectric effect is nothing but, you know, the conversion of, you know, mechanical energy into the equivalent voltage. Suppose if I represent a block diagram for the piezoelectric effect, okay, any mechanical pressure applied here, okay, I am saying mechanical pressure, okay. It may be your foot pressure or it may be the hand pressure, any pressure if you apply on this, you know, the crystal, okay. So, at the output you are going to see some kind of oscillations. In fact, you see the alternating current, okay, AC current here, that in turn generates an oscillations here, okay. That is the idea behind this, you know, the meaning of piezoelectric effect here. So, piezoelectric effect means influence of the mechanical pressure, the voltage gets generated across the opposite faces of the crystal. A crystal is basically the octagon, you know, in shape. Okay, so whenever the a pressure is made to fall on one side of the crystal, on the opposite face you are going to get an oscillations. Okay, so that's the idea behind this crystal oscillator. Okay, crystals are generally either naturally they are available also. Okay, you can choose the crystals which are naturally occurring, or also crystals can be synthetically manufactured. A crystal comes in two different ways here. But even though naturally available crystals are there, we can cut into different shapes, okay, depending on your requirement here. Okay, but here, as we said, that when the mechanical pressure is made to fall on one side of the one face of the crystal, on the other side of the opposite side of the crystal, you see the now generation of, you know, the voltage, and that's nothing but an AC voltage. Okay, so what happens if the AC voltage is applied across the crystal? So definitely it generates some, you know, the vibrations, and that causes, you know, a mechanical distortion within the crystal shape, and the chances are the crystal shape may also change, okay, due to the mechanical vibration. Vice versa also it is true here, but we are using in the other way. So we are using here to generate this crystal oscillator as an oscillator point of view here. Okay, so crystal oscillator, the reason for choosing is because it generates a constant frequency. The frequency generation by other circuits like Hartley, Colpitt, RC phase shift is not constant, but this generate constant frequency. And also these circuits are also called as tuned circuit, oscillator circuit, or also can be the tank circuit here is also called as resonant tank circuit here. The different names we give here. Crystal oscillators are preferred because of its frequency stability, as I mentioned already. Crystals are used in watches, communication, transmitters, receivers, and even digital systems also. Now let us talk about little bit about crystal. Okay, so the main substance which is used in the crystal is basically, there are totally three types of crystals are available. One is quartz crystal, rockily salt, and tourmaline crystal. So these are the three types of crystals are there. Among these three types of, you know, the substances that exhibit piezoelectric effect, the quartz is preferred from a strength point of view, and even the frequency of oscillation point of view, we prefer, and also cost also, another term is cost. Cost point of view, we prefer quartz. The important properties of rockily salt is, you know, it has got a great piezoelectric effect, okay, compared to the other other, you know, piezoelectric substances. That's one advantage of, you know, the rockily salt compared to the quartz and tourmaline. The strong, greatest you know, the piezoelectric activity you can see in that. That's why they are used in the manufacturing of, you know, the microphones for the portable tape recorders, headsets, loudspeakers, and all this, you know, the products we use this, you know, rockily salt. Rockily salt is basically, the other thing about rockily salt is it's mechanically weakest, you know, of compared all the three, and it can break very easily. That's the drawback of rockily salt. And when you see the tourmaline kind of, you know, the substance, this has got mechanically it is very much strong, and but it's most expansive compared to the quartz and rockily salt here. When you look at all these parameters, the quartz is a compromise between, you know, rockily salt and tourmaline here. So that's why quartz is preferred in almost all, you know, the LC oscillators here. So quartz is because of inexpensive and easily available in nature, and also can be synthetically manufactured also. So that's why it is used in all crystal oscillators. So we understood the piezoelectric effect. Then we understood different substances which exhibit piezoelectric effect. And here we concluded that quartz is the material used in the crystal oscillator because the piezoelectric effect here generates oscillations here. Now let us go through the constructional details of this crystal oscillator. So look at here, this is a crystal, as you can see here, though a crystal is available in hexagonal shape here, but we cut into the rectangular slab, as you can see here, It's just similar to the, if you look at in a 3D point of view, it's like a brick kind of, you know, the appearance here. Though we show here a 2D like this, but it is a 3D shape, look, appears to be like this. And on top of this, there is a one layer, and bottom there is a one more, which is a holding plate, what we call here. And between these two holding plates, there is a crystal slab which is mentioned here. The quartz crystal is used here, and this is the one which is responsible for generation of oscillation. Okay, so the quartz is mounted between the two plates here. Okay, this is a symbolic representation of a crystal. Okay, and there are two metal plates which are holding them, and of course this exhibits a capacitance also. This is called mounting capacitance. So we'll see that in the equivalent circuit here. Let us now move on to the AC equivalent circuit of the crystal. AC equivalent circuit of the crystal has got the three elements which are in series, namely the R, L and the C. Okay, as you can see here, this is one side, and parallel to this you will see the mounting, you know, the capacitance. Okay, a mounting capacitance CM, which is in parallel to all these three elements here. So this is the overall equivalent circuit of the crystal. Okay, the main reason, because we are looking from electronic point of view, though crystal is a mechanical substance, from electronic point of view it's equivalent to the three elements RLC connected in series, and due to the crystal mounted between the two parallel plates, the parallel plates also exhibit a capacitance here, that is called as a mounting capacitance here. Okay, now let us go through the still a few more details here. So when it is vibrating, there are internal frictional forces which are denoted by the resistance here. The reason is given why we include this, you know, element in the equivalent circuit as resistance, inductance and capacitance. Because of the, when the crystal is vibrating, there are some, you know, the forces, you know, frictional losses will happen within the crystal, that is shown as a resistance here. And also the mass of the crystal, which is nothing but which exhibits inertia, that is shown as inductance L here. And also in vibrating condition it has some stiffness, the some energy which is holding that, okay, the come in within the crystal, that is shown as stiffness here, and that's indicated as a capacitor. And since the entire crystal is mounted within two parallel plates, that is shown as a inductance here. So we need to understand the importance of these three elements, you know, these four elements together, why we have used here in the equivalent circuit. Now we are going to develop circuit based on this, okay, because from electronic perspective the crystal is now equivalent to the AC circuit, which is AC equivalent circuit shown here. Now let us move on to the frequency of oscillation. The resonating frequency is very important here. We don't call here simply frequency, we call here as resonating frequency, because whenever there is a match between this, you know, the L and C, okay, so the maximum, you know, resonance will take place, and therefore the resonating frequency FR is given as 1 by 2 pi square root of LC into root of Q square divided by 1 plus Q square, and Q is called as a quality factor of the crystal. This value we expect to be very high. Higher the quality factor, you know, this factor tends to become unity. Okay, so when this becomes unity, then the frequency of oscillation becomes 1 by 2 pi into square root of LC, which is same as okay, LC oscillator frequency here. Okay, so the quality factor must be as large as possible for the, okay, so this crystal oscillator here. The quality factor is given by omega L by R. Okay, so this is the omega, means its angular frequency, and L is nothing but inductance, R is the resistance here. The quality factor of the crystal is very high, typically it is 20,000, and it can go up to all the way up to 10 to the power of 6. So when this becomes very large, as I told you, this square root of Q square divided by 1 plus Q square, because Q is larger here. So when this becomes large, so this 1 can be neglected here, so therefore Q square and square root cancels each other, and therefore you end up with only 1 here. Okay, so that's the advantage we are going to gain when the quality factor is very high. And so when this entire expression for the, you know, the quality factor becomes unity, the final resonating frequency is given by this expression here. Okay, and also the crystal frequency is inversely proportional to the thickness of the crystal here. Sometimes, you know, when the thickness is given, you can also relate that to the frequency here, because f and t are inversely proportional to each other. Okay, smaller the thickness, you will have a higher the frequency here. That's the advantage you are going to gain. Okay, that's what it is told here. Okay, but also sometimes it get damaged when the crystal becomes very thin. You must be careful about that. Practically, crystals are used for generation of frequency of, you know, the 200 or 300 kilohertz. Okay, so the resonating frequencies are very important here. And when we say resonating frequency here, there are two types of, you know, as you have seen here, the two capacitances are there. When these two elements, you know, resonate together, then it is called series resonance. When the other elements, like, you know, the this mounting capacitance get resonant with this L2 elements here, then it is called parallel resonance here. Depending on the, since there are two, this entire four elements can be clustered into two ways, the series element and the parallel element here. When this L and C are resonating, you know, together, then it is called as a series resonance. When L and C resonate with CM, it is called parallel resonance here. So that's why the formula now keeps changing for series resonance and the parallel resonance. Let us now talk about this resonance now. One resonant condition occurs when the reactance series RLC leg are equal XL and XC when they are equal here. In the series, we have seen that when the inductance reactance becomes equal to capacitance capacitive reactance here, then the series resonance will take place here. So under this resonant condition here, the impedance offered by the branch is going to be minimum, and which is the nothing but equal to the resistance here. Then the frequency of operation for the this is given by Fs is equal to 1 by 2 pi LC, whereas C is nothing but which is the capacitance used here. This is the capacitance here. For parallel resonance, you know, the formula will slightly change here. For parallel resonance, we must use this C and the CM, both becomes, you know, in series. So this is the equivalent capacitance for the parallel resonance. When the capacitance C is resonating with the mounting capacitance, then the type of resonance becomes parallel resonance here. So C equivalent is equal to CM into C divided by CM plus C. That is the formula for equivalent capacitance. This can be used in this formula of frequency of operation. Now parallel resonance is given by Fp is equal to 1 by 2 pi into square root of L into C equivalent here. Okay. So these are the formulas which you need to be aware for series and parallel resonance here. And when the crystal capacitance is very small, okay, then the mounting capacitance, in such case, you know, the impedance, you know, frequency which is plotted here, as you can see here, the x-axis is frequency, and in the y-axis we have the impedance here, and there are two resonant frequencies we have shown here, series resonant frequency and parallel resonant frequency. When the C becomes equal to CM, okay, under such case, the graph is shown here. If you look at graph here, Fs and Fp more or less are equal here. So under series resonance, whenever there is a C and CM, both are smaller. C is smaller than CM. Under such cases, either one of this can be considered, because both of them are going to be equal. Either Fs or Fp can be considered here. Okay, that's very close to each other, and practically it can be said that there exists only one resonating frequency for a crystal. Whenever this C becomes smaller than CM, it's not 10 here. This is C becoming smaller than CM. Under such condition, Fs will become equal to Fp here. So we can choose any one resonating frequency here. Higher the value of Q is main advantage, because the quality factor we expect to be very large. Okay, high quality factor means it provides very good stability of oscillations. That's an important here. And if the resistance is neglected, the equivalent impedance of the crystal is just can be calculated here. So it is minus J by 1 by omega CM into omega square minus omega S square divided by omega square minus omega P square. This is the equivalent impedance when the resistance is neglected here. Now the reactance, when the when we plot, you know, the reactance, inductive reactance as a function of, you know, the frequency, as you can see here in this case, there is a omega p here and omega s, omega s here, which you can see this is a series resonance, okay, with which varies with reference to the capacitor inductive reactance, and you can see there is a omega p, which is the at some point of you know, frequency, at some point where there is a close match between this graph and this graph, this is a line which you can see here. So the omega p is now very close to this omega s, so that this can be preferred as another frequency. The oscillating frequency lies between omega s and omega p. Okay, this graph is basically a reactance graph versus the frequency here. Okay, so this is a frequency variation with reference to the impedance here. Okay, so what is important in this case is the series resonance and parallel resonance formula, and the crystal oscillator, how it generates oscillations, the equivalent circuit, and the working of crystal. So these things are very important from examination point of view. So other things, I think I leave it for you for self study. Okay, so like we can also develop circuits, you know, based on the crystal oscillator, as you can see here. This is called a Peirce crystal oscillator. We can see a tank circuit here and the an amplifier circuit here. This works more or less like, you know, Colpitt or, you know, the Hartley oscillator. Okay, so there are different versions of, you know, the Peirce crystal oscillator. One is FET version and using transistor based. I suggest you to study this kind of, you know, FET based oscillator, because they are much better than the BJT based oscillator. There is a Miller crystal oscillator also, which you can see here. Okay, so this is also important. This is BJT based. Similarly, you can also construct FET based. Okay, just replace BJT with an FET. And there are a couple of problems. I am leaving this problems for you to work out at home. Okay, so there are plenty of problems which are there in this material. Kindly go through this each and every problem and become familiar yourself. Okay, there is no derivation part in this topic. I strongly urge students to go through all these problems. Okay, solve on yourself all these problems, and it's self-explanatory also. Okay, there's so many problems which is given here. Okay, which are useful for examination point of view. Okay, with that I think we'll stop here. If there are any questions, I would like to take it offline.